I recently realized that we humans are really good at pitching end of the world. I mean, take any film. Aliens, viruses, microwaves, or zombies. And considering this skill of ours, it's no wonder that when we are faced with stuff like climate crisis, our imagination, reinforced with the horrendous data, goes like... And I'm not so convinced that this narrative serves you, I mean, us all that well. This is WDNTD Idiot, whatever, show where I talk to experts on sustainability to illuminate possible pathways to a world where we are not being such a dicks to one another and the rest of the nature. And as a student of humanities, it's very clear for me how a narrative in one's head can eventually shape the course of whole society. I study religious studies, so no, let's not go into this, but this is the reason why for today's show I invited Rob Hopkins, who's a co-founder of Transition Town Initiative. So come, Rob, join me here. You see, I had to really pull some strings to get Rob on today's show. Please, Rob, be still. Come here to me. And there we go. Hello, hello.
Hello.
So what do you reckon, Rob? What might be the strategy for the humanity to go from this collapse narrative towards one that is more functional on the road towards post-climate crisis world?
We have to be really careful what we wish for, because there's a real danger that if we just assume that it's inevitable and we just sit back and wait to be engulfed in the wave of collapse, then we've created a self-fulfilling prophecy. Me, yes, if we do nothing and we just carry on with business as usual, then it's very likely that many aspects of civilization will collapse, because that's what the scientists tell us what will happen when we reach a 2-degree world, a 3-degree world. Our food systems will collapse, our ecosystems will collapse, it'll be awful. But they always say, if we do everything that we could possibly do now, we can avoid those worst case scenarios. That's the window that I kind of hang on to. And for me, that is really about storytelling and about imagination and about longing. Because if we can create in our culture a deep longing for a different vision of the future, and it has to be profoundly different. As Naomi Klein says, there are no non-radical solutions left. We have to reimagine our food system, our education system, our transport system. Everything has to be reimagined. And we have to create a culture where we foster that kind of imagination, that culture of imagination and possibility, where we go, great, fantastic, wow, we can reimagine everything. How brilliant. Wow, what would our food system be like? Oh, what does that mean for how our kids grow up and what cities look like? You know, that, how do we develop that kind of longing? Because once you create the longing, everything else is the easy bit. And when Neil Armstrong went to the moon, that wasn't his idea or JFK's idea. That was something which we had been going to the moon for decades before then, in songs and stories. And Tintin went to the moon and Frank Sinatra sang us to the moon. It meant by 1960, when JFK announced we were going to the moon, the longing was so powerful. We did it in 9 years, and the average age of the team who did it was 26.
6 years ago, I watched In Transition films. They document communities that take responsibility for the neighborhood's well-being and also carbon footprint in order to become more self-sufficient and resilient. To do so, they would build community gardens, set up local currencies, or even stuff like running a community solar power plant. Watching these films inspired me and my mates at that time that we started our own community garden that later on sparked into very different kinds of projects here in Tartu that somehow contribute to carbon neutral future. And being involved in such projects and sharing the stories of them is kind of a building block for more functional narrative. Or as Rob puts it,
we are only as imaginative as we have good things in our memory. When we are being imaginative, we're going to the cupboards of our memory, which are basically in the same part of the brain as where your imagination comes from. We're looking through the cupboards and we're going, oh, right, what have we got in here? Okay, what happens if we put that together with that and create something new? And the imagination is that unique creation of something that has emerged from putting things together. But we have to have the cupboards of our imagination full of great stories and good ideas from around the place. It's one of the reasons why your video series is going to be so important, that actually people need to hear those stories. Because that's what gives us a stronger sense of possibility.
I made this video out of an understanding that there is a lot of humans anxious about the climate crisis and the future it may bring. And I mean, it makes sense. The corporations are evil, governments addicted to GDP, and the data is clear. We are heading to the end of the civilization. Cool. This story is necessary to keep in mind what to avoid, but it's kind of useless at aiming where to go. And unfortunately, to many, this is the only narrative to tell oneself about this issue. I believe we need to popularize an understanding that if we solve this one, we gonna have so much better time, and like really take this climate crisis as an opportunity. Then we can focus on much more important things, like playing with dogs in a park. And to do so, we need a vision what might the ideal post-climate crisis world actually look like.
Successful navigation through the realm of your reality depends on clear visions. A for those timelines of what you would call the future that contain the least amount of suffering.
Yeah, whatever. One last idea for this video. In a previous century, there was an experiment conducted on two lab rats. Which one would solve a maze faster? They both knew that in the finish there would be a cheese waiting for them. The first one had all the time in the universe to solve it. The other one was being scared with an odor of a cat. The latter one solved it much, much faster. So let's be like the second lab rat, which you humans are definitely not, whatever. Let's keep the image of the collapse in the back of our heads while aiming at the cheese. Because without the image of the cheese, we might even never solve the labyrinth. Big thanks again to Rob Hopkins for joining me for this episode. If you are interested in similar ideas, definitely go check out his podcast. This was the first episode of this YouTube series. Please let me know in the comment section what you think about the format. Thank you for watching. Subscribe to this YouTube channel. It's gonna be a ride.